Hello, it's Keith here, and this is the 9th in the platform-specific series of my 6502 assembly programming tutorials. We've come to the last of this series of bitmap lessons for the moment. We're going to be looking at the Commodore 64. Now, the Commodore 64 is very famous, of course, and it's probably the most popular of the 6502 computers, not counting the NES, of course. So I decided to leave this one last so that I could try and do the best job that I could of it. Now, that said, I'm not the most experienced person on the Commodore 64, so please just consider this an introduction lesson for beginners. If you're already familiar with the Commodore 64, you'd probably want to go to a more advanced lesson on someone else's site, because, as I say, I'm only able to show you the basics because I'm originally an Amstrad CPC Z80 programmer, and I've only learned enough about the Commodore 64 to do programming for my Grime 6502 games. So bearing that in mind, let's start today's lesson. So in this series, we've been looking at bitmap graphics on lots of systems. With this Commodore 64, we're going to be doing that again. I say that because the Commodore 64 has multiple screen options. It has text-based modes with redefinable characters and bitmap modes, and we're going to look at both of the bitmap modes today, but we're not going to look at the text modes. Now, why are we doing that? Well, we always want to try and do a common thing on all of our systems, and ideally we want to have bitmap graphics. We're going to look at both modes because both have advantages and disadvantages. Now, in the two-color mode, that's just one bit per pixel, we have a screen resolution of 320 by 200, which is, of course, the same as the Amstrad CPC. For someone like myself who comes from that platform originally, that's quite a nice thing to have compared to, say, the MSX, which is 256 by 192. However, that two-color limitation is a bit unfortunate. We have alternatively the four color mode, which is what I used in Grime 6502. This is 160 by 200, again, very much mimicking the resolution of the Amstrad CPC in its 16 color mode. And of course, that screen mode can have four colors. Now, in both cases, these are effectively color attribute based systems. So the two color mode is kind of like the spectrum, and the four color mode would be something a bit like the Nintendo NES, which also has four colors per tile. So we're going to look at the bitmaps today. We're going to have a look at how to set the colors in a later lesson. So the first thing we need to discuss is how the screen works on the Commodore 64. It's very much like the BBC, if you caught my lesson on that. You need to think of consecutive bytes in memory and how they actually appear on the screen. So you might have 8 consecutive bytes in memory, but they won't appear as 8 consecutive bytes from the left to the right on a single horizontal line on the screen. On the Commodore 64, like the BBC, 8 consecutive bytes actually go down within one 8 pixel tall strip of Y coordinates. So effectively, we're kind of working in character blocks. So 8 consecutive bytes will go down, but then the 9th byte will jump back up. So you're kind of zigzagging along the screen in this method until you get to the far right-hand side of the screen, and then you jump back all the way to the left again. This was the same as on the BBC, and the Commodore 64 works basically in the same way. So the point I'm making is we zigzag across the screen. So how do we actually set up the screen on the Commodore 64? Well, as with most systems, we have some memory mapped registers. So we have some various addresses, and if we set certain values to those, that will configure the screen for us. Once we've got our screen set up, other memory addresses will have various functions with regards to defining the data on the screen and the colors. The basic data that makes up the pixel data is in the memory address range 2000 to 3FFF. And beyond that, we have a default area of what's known as screen area, and this actually takes on the property of color information in the four color mode. In addition to that, we have some extra color information all the way over here at hexadecimal D800, and this is the two color mode information and is also used in the four color mode as well. So we've got a wide variety of addresses here that have some purpose with regards to the screen. The Commodore 64, of course, also has sprites, but we're not going to look at those either today. That's all going to be in later lessons. Now, as I've already said, we're not really going to cover color information here today, but I do want to just explain very quickly that there is on my website a quick lookup for the various memory locations that will be used to define the color depending on the bits within the binary data of our bitmap. So if we've got a four color bitmap, a combination of 00 will use the background color, 01 will use the low nibble of the text screen memory, which is this default memory area just here. If it's 10, then it will use the high nibble of that range, and if it's 11, it will use the so-called color memory at the D800 range. So let's see today's example in action then. So as with all of our tutorials, we're going to show our Chibico character on the screen. It's not very visible here because of the poor color choice, but the principle stands. You can see the little character there, and let's try it in four color mode, which will hopefully... Now let's try it in four color mode, and hopefully it'll look a bit better. So all I need to do is disable this mode two color option here and recompile. And now we have a four color character here. Now, an important thing to notice is the code is actually reprogramming itself depending on whether that definition is defined or not. But in addition to that, the bitmap data is actually different. Now, with all of my tutorials, you can use my AcuSprite editor here, and we'll just load in the file that is used in these tutorials. So this AcuSprite editor can export into formats for all of the systems in my tutorials. We've got a Commodore 64 option here. We've got a two color option here, a four color option here, and you can see I'm going to be covering sprites later on. So all of the systems I cover in my tutorials are exportable, at least to a basic level, from AcuSprite editor here. So it's free, it's open source, it's included in the sources file if you go to my website and download the sources for these tutorials. So that's the result of what we're actually doing today. Let's start having a look at the actual source code. So the first thing we're doing is we're doing some basic initialization of our screen here. This is to set up the screen mode that we want. Now, the first thing we're doing is we're turning on the graphics mode here. Now, effectively, this bit combination is a sort of fixed set of settings. There's not really anything you're going to want to change here, I don't think. So if you just write this combination of bits to hexadecimal D011, you're effectively turning on the graphics mode. Now, the next option we need to set in combination with that is D016. This selects the color depth in the graphics mode, and it's just this bit here that will define whether we're in four color mode or if we're in two color mode. So you can see here we're changing it according to if this definition is defined. And so that's the first part of changing the functionality of this program to define either two or four colors. We've now selected our video mode, but we want to define where the memory is. Now, if we set this bit to one, then we're defining that the graphic screen is going to be a hexadecimal 2000. Now, I believe if we set this to zero, then the memory address would be at memory address zero, which is very strange if you think about the zero page being a zero and the stack being a hexadecimal 100. I don't know if there's any way you can use that. That sounds very impractical to me. Now, there are some extra bits, these two here, which do have an effect on the text-based graphic mode's memory address, but they have no function for the bitmap mode address. It's only this one bit that we have an option for, and so we only have those two options, and as I say, the one doesn't seem to be usable to me. And then finally, we're setting a default background color, just so that things are starting up nicely for that two color mode. So that's the initialization we do when we get started running our program. Now, beyond that, what do we do? Well, these tutorials have three different functionality modes. They have the tile mode that we've seen in the past, they've got the bitmap mode, and they've got the bitmap BBC mode, which is a little bit less efficient than the bitmap mode because of this complex screen layout. And what we do is we use a command called getScreenPos. This converts an XY coordinate into a memory location. And what we do with this is we actually work out where we want to draw our Chibico character, the bitmap. GetScreenPos converts an XY screen coordinate into a memory position and stores it in ZDE. DE is for destination, that's a zero page entry mimicking the Z80 registers there. I like to work in that way. We've also got HL, which is our source data of our bitmap. It's included into the bottom of this file as a binary file. And we've got our size, which is just defined here and also here. And these are defining the size of the bitmap we're drawing to the screen. So really, all we're doing here is we're copying data from the source to the destination, and we're using this getScreenPos command, which is recalculating where in memory we want to write to. So let's have a look at that getScreenPos command now. And here it is, and unfortunately you'll see it's really quite long. Why is it so long? Well, it's the complexity of the screen memory again. Now, what you need to think about is the screen memory. As I've said, we're working basically in a zigzag format, and actually let's just see that in action now. So what I've done here is I've put in a pause into the code, and now you can see that the bitmap is drawing very slowly, and you can see it's going down and then it's jumping across. Now, these are all consecutive bytes in this zigzag pattern here, but then when we get to the end of the line, we're needing to recalculate to work out the position of the next line here, because of course the following bytes would continue all the way across the screen here until it got to here and then jump along back to here. And this is of course aligned by the character blocks. That's very important to understand with this. So that's the pattern that we're needing to work with for the Commodore 64 screen. And how are we going to cope with that? Well, we've got a formula here. What we need to do when we want to work out the memory location of an XY position is we need to split the Y position into two parts, the bottom three bits, which is 0 to 7, because as I've said, we're zigzagging within that tile block, but then the remaining five bits of the Y coordinate work out which tile block we're in as we go down the screen. So what we're doing is we're splitting those into two and we're treating them differently. Now, because each visible pixel horizontally is separated by 8 vertical bytes within the memory, we actually have to multiply the x position by 8 when we want to calculate it. We then need to remove the bottom 3 bits of the Y position and then multiply that by 40. The reason for this is there's 160 pixels across the screen. 4 bits per pixel means 40 bytes. And then what we do is we add the remaining bottom 3 bits of the Y position, because as I've said, as we go down the screen, each 8 consecutive horizontal lines are within a common block and they are consecutive bytes in memory. Finally, we need to add the offset of the screen, which is hexadecimal 2000. Now, when it comes to doing multiplication, of course, the 6502 can't really do it. So what we're going to do is we're going to cheat and we're going to do multiplication by bit shifting. And I've just noticed that should be a 0 there. I'll have to get that corrected. And so what we're doing is we're loading in our X position into a bottom byte of a byte pair, and then we're bit shifting 3 times to the left. And effectively, we are multiplying by 8 by doing that. We're going to do the same with the Y position. Firstly, we're going to set the bottom 3 bits to 0. Then we're going to shift along by 3 bits to the left. We're going to add that to a running total, shift by another 2 bits to the left, and add that to a running total. And that effectively multiplies this part by 40. Then we're just going to add this part and the base here. And we're going to see that in the code now. So here's the get screen pause command. Now we've got a push pair command here. This is actually a macro. It pushes both parts of the zero page entry ZBC into the stack, and the pull pair gets them back here later. And that's just so that we're not affecting those values in this function here. So when we execute this function, we are going to take the XY position in the X and Y registers, and we're going to return a destination in memory in D and E. And so we're going to use that formula we just saw. So let's just move that along here so we can maybe see it. So this is our formula, and you're going to see this in action just here. So firstly, what we're doing is we're transferring X into the accumulator, and we're shifting it to the left 3 times here. And so we've effectively multiplied X by 8 here. And then we're storing that in E here. Next, what we're doing is we're taking the Y value and we're zeroing the bottom 3 bits because we only want to take the top 5 bits here. And then we're multiplying that by 40. And as I've said already, the way we do this is we shift to the left 3 times. We then store that into DE and add it to B here. And then what we're doing is we're shifting by another 2 times here, and we're then adding that to the running total from before. Once we've done that, we're then adding hexadecimal 20 to ZB, which is effectively adding 2000, because of course BC is a zero page pair to make a 16-bit number. And then the last thing we're doing is we're adding any remaining 3 bits from the Y value, and that's the bottom 3 bits that we mentioned just here. One final trick I've got added in here is there's a possible offset to simulate a 256 by 192 screen. Because the C64 screen is 320 by 200, it's actually quite a bit bigger. So to allow GRIME650 to work in a common way on all the systems, I actually offset the larger screens so that the smaller virtual screen is centralized. So that's all that's doing there. And that's really all there is to it. Now, it's a bit complex here, and if you don't understand it, you can just use this command as is. It's only if you want to convert it to make it work with something else a bit more efficiently, which may be something you would want to do. If you were always working with 8x8 character blocks, for example, you could just remove this code here. And, you know, maybe there would be a case where you would want to calculate the X position and the Y position separately. You know, maybe you were starting at the far left-hand side of the screen or something. Now, it is important to point out that if we're within an 8x8 character block and we want to move down the screen, we can just increment DE, because of course, until we get to that 8th byte when we jump back up, then we can just move down by incrementing DE. But unlike the other systems, it's not going to be really very easy to recalculate the line just below that 8th byte. So what I'm doing here is I'm recalculating the screen line once we've done a strip 8 pixels tall and however wide the bitmap is. And that's what I'd probably suggest you would want to do in this case. So there we go. So we just saw a very simple example of how to get bitmap graphics on the screen. And I know it's nothing special considering what the C64 can do, but this was enough for me to get GRIME650 working, which you can see here. and I think it's enough for, to give you something to get started with and allow you to get some basic graphics on the screen. There is of course an alternate version of this kind of code which is drawing this bitmap font onto the screen as well. I'm not going to go over that in today's lesson because it's essentially just a reworking of the same code. So if you've understood what you've seen so far, I think it's going to be pretty straightforward to you. And if you were struggling with the code that calculates the screen addresses today, then I don't think it's something you really need to see anyway, because as I say, because as from the point of view of getting the fonts onto the screen, it was just about being able to work in a common way on all of our systems. It's not something I think you really need to know at this stage. Anyway, I hope you've enjoyed this. If you have, please share it onto the social networks, because that really helps new people find my channel. And we're going to be coming back to the Commodore 64 to learn how to do colours, because of course the Grime 6502 game, you can see it's got lots of colour on it, so we're going to need to learn how to do that. We're going to also learn about sprites later, and of course sound and things like that. Anyway, I hope you've enjoyed this lesson. Thanks for watching and goodbye.